This programme was funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with the television licence fee.
Hi, I'm Jordan McCarthy, and welcome along to Leading the Field. In this six-part series, I will explore the strong horse racing culture in the East Cork, West Waterford area. A book dated from the year 1652 documents horse matches taking place on the Strand in Youghal. The area of East Cork and West Waterford has had quite a lot of success in the 364 years or so since. We now rival Kildare for the home of racing title. You could say we are leading the field. The people of the East Cork, West Waterford area have had remarkable success in the sport of kings, on both a national and indeed international scale. My venture to explain the locals' love affair with racing begins here in Youghal, home of the dual champion jockey and Cheltenham Festival winning rider, Davy Russell. One of the best sportsmen the area has produced, Davy has certainly made his impact on the sport, establishing himself as one of the best jockeys to have graced the turf. But how did he catch the racing bug?
Dad obviously was very busy. He was farming and we had the garage below. But to be fair, you know, there was always horses and ponies around. You know, when we got a pony when I was about, I'd say I was about 11 or 12. And, you know, it all stemmed from there. I always wanted to ride horses anyway, you know, and then obviously as I grow older, and Dad would often have a horse in training, and you know, we'd go and visit it with John Coyley or Pat Buds or Frank O'Brien down in Piltown. He's David O'Brien's dad. He'd often have a horse in training with the likes of them, and you know, we'd go visit the yard, and maybe I might sit up on a horse. Jimmy Mangan, he often had a horse with Jimmy Mangan, and I'd sit up on the horse, maybe ride it to the gallop, and then a jockey would get up on it and ride it in the gallop. You know, it all stemmed from there, really.
And Dave, you've obviously many fond memories of growing up in Youghal. Was it tough leaving?
I love Youghal. I had the best childhood ever. You know, we grew up on a farm in the town, so I had the best of both lives, really. We had great fun. Obviously, my cousins are very close by, and I used to head off then during the summers, and I just miss Youghal, really, because there's be great festivals on, and with the beach and everything. It's a marvellous place to grow up for any child, really, you know. The first time I left home, really, was when I was about 13 or 14. We went to the races in Tramore with Dad, and Frank O'Brien had a runner, and literally on the day, I had no plans of going away or anything, but I just jumped up in the lorry with Frank O'Brien and I headed off for a couple of weeks down to him, and tipped away then riding racehorses down there. Then every summer after, or every holiday after, you know, Easter or whatever, I used to go to either Pat Buds's or Jimmy Mangan's or down to Frank O'Brien's, and you know, again, loads of experience. And then I spent this couple of summers with Jim Bulger, and I spent a bit of time in Dermot Wells. I was lucky, to be fair, and they were all by chance. I just rang him up and asked him for a job, and to be fair, they took me on. Learned loads, learned an awful lot in Jim Bulger's. He's a masterful man. He teaches the people that are in the yard, you know. It's you're not just there as an employee, you're there to learn, really. It's an education. I was lucky enough that way. I'd no huge interest in school, you know. I just thought I'd be better off working. And I went off then and I got a job in Jimmy Mangan's, working in the mornings, and I used to work in the nights in Brown's in the fish factory. And I spent a year, you know, a couple of months to a season doing that, boning fish and riding out in the morning, going, getting a couple of hours nap in the day. And I was happy doing that, you know. I always had a few quid in my pocket. And then we had a horse here at home that I used to ride out in the mornings before I go to work. And she ran the Pint of Pint, so she was my first ride. And Pat Buds then gave me a ride in a bumper because Martin had got suspended in Tipperary after riding a winner, and I rode a horse for Pat and Breda. And it went on then. I went to Jimmy's and I was getting a few rides, and I worked for Eugene O'Sullivan as well. I got an awful lot of experience in Eugene O'Sullivan's. I got a couple of rides on the track, and over fences and point to points, but I still had no winter road, you know. You know, all this was over a period of time, so I turned, you know, I was 19, I think, at the time, and we used to go to Boole to schooling after Jimmy's. There'd be a number of trainers around the area. You'd get an old spare or something, and I was just lucky enough I was there one day, and I wasn't doing anything, and Pat O'Connor arrived on with a couple of horses, and they were short of jockeys, so I schooled him, a horse called Spanish Castle, and then it came to that horse to run, and one of the riders wasn't available to ride him, and I was in the way tent, and I rode him, and it was literally like that. It was just on the day, really, and he won. And amazingly, after that, I think every Sunday after, for about 5 or 6 or 7 Sundays, I rode a winner every Sunday.
Davey went on to cement his place among the best riders in the point-to-point circuit, himself and JT McNamara going at it hammer and tongs for the leading jockey's title. Davey went on to seal that jockey's title on the point-to-point circuit, and did so on 2 occasions before the decision was then made for Davey to ply his trade as a jockey inside the rails. How did it come about?
Very quick, and again another local man, Tom O'Mahony. I was going up to walk the point-to-point course in Boole of a Wednesday or Thursday. It was on that weekend, and I was just going up to walk the track, and I pulled in the gate, and Tom O'Mahony pulled in after me, and he said, you know, I'd like to have sit down and have a chat with you, you know, that there may be a job coming up. So I said, lovely, you know, I always wanted to ride every day of the week, you know, point-to-points were great. You'd ride of a Sunday, and maybe you may have a ride of a Thursday in Thurles or Clonmel or somewhere like that, and maybe a Saturday in Naas or Leopardstown if you're lucky enough. But I wanted to ride every day over fences, and Tom approached me and he said, there's a job in England, would you like it to meet Ferdy? And I said, I would, of course, and we met up, and that was it. And literally of a Sunday I rode in a point-to-point, and on Tuesday I was a professional. I had my first ride in Hereford, I think, and I got beaten on it, and I rode my first winner in Sedgefield in England for Ferdy as a professional. And, you know, we had a great couple of years. It lasted a couple of years, and, you know, we were second in the Gold Cup and plenty of good winners, you know, Tommy Whittle chase and a couple of big handicaps around Ascot and places. And when I turned professional, I didn't know anything about handicaps or ratings or anything dealing with owners or anything like that. I used to just turn up on a Sunday. Like, when I was riding point-to-points, people used to be looking for me. You know, I was never short of a riding a point-to-point. I was always riding good horses for good trainers, you know, Liam Burke and Pat Doyle and all of them. When I turned professional, it was very different. I was riding for Ferdy, and I had to speak to owners, and you'd explain things, and I was trying to explain things that I didn't know anything about. And it took a bit of time to learn.
But learn he did. While in Britain, Davey was still very much in demand back in Ireland. This prompted a return home after 2 seasons spent across the water with Ferdy Murphy. On his return, Davey established fruitful partnerships with leading trainers such as Charles Burns and Arthur Moore, trainers he still rides for to this day. Having shown his talent and ability to ride winners, the all-powerful Jigginstown House stud set up and took notice.
I suppose I had a bit of an association with him because I'd rode some winners for them through Pat Doyle, because I had a lot of success with Pat Doyle in the point-to-points, and he had horses in training for the O'Learys, and I rode a couple of winners for him. When Conor O'Dwyer wasn't available, he was a retained rider at the time, and then Conor retired, and they needed a replacement rider, and they asked me.
It was a fantastic period in Davey's career as he carried the famous maroon and white silks to victory aboard horses such as Sir Deschamps, First Lieutenant and Weapons Amnesty. As retained rider to Jigginstown, he sealed that much sought after champion jockey's title in 2012. It was a huge relief.
When I was champion as an amateur, and then some people were telling me, you know, you could be champion amateur for the rest of your life. And it was kind of, you know, I'd been knocking on the door kind of for about 5 years, finishing second to Ruby and then to Paul Townend, which was really tough because, you know, you think that if Ruby wasn't there, you'd be champion. And then Paul, you know, we all know is such a good rider, and he took up the mantle from Ruby when he got injured, and I couldn't beat him without the Jigginstown job. And then I got it, and then finally you know, I got my head in front and I was champion jockey, and I followed it up the year after being champion jockey. So it was marvellous. It was brilliant with such a long journey from being collecting awards as an amateur and not collecting any as a professional, and then suddenly getting two championships was marvellous.
Davy has given his family and friends in Youghal some wonderful moments. Parents Gerry and Phyllis are two popular locals in the seaside town. What has their son's success been like for them? Dad Gerry is understandably full of praise for Davy, both on and off the race course.
We are very proud of him. He's a great lad. Doesn't drink, which I'm very happy about. Minds himself. Maybe a small bit of a problem with his weight, but nowadays, with all the dietitians and all, he seemed to have it better under control. He was champion novice pint-a-pinter. He was champion senior pint-a-pinter twice. He was national hunt champion twice. He rode a lot of winners in Cheltenham. He rode a lot of grade one winners. What he has done in his career, it was done by no other jockey in Ireland, and the way he's come right up through the ranks. Even when he was pony riding, he had a brilliant pony. He was an absolute brilliant pony. But I think, really, look, he was part of the making of a really. If you meant good enough, you would make a horse too, like. And I think, look, he was lucky enough to get pony good enough when he was a young fella at the right age, at 12 years of age. She was absolute genius of a pony. And she went on and she jumped international now. It was the people that bought her, she jumped international. But I think he made her. He's a great lad. He's lucky enough. He's been basically fairly injury-free.
And what a fantastic Cheltenham record he has, Gerry.
You hear fellas talking about Terry Bibblecombe being a great jockey. Terry Bibblecombe, being based in England, being with a good trainer and a good owners, he rode about 12 or 13 winners. David has ridden 16 so far, so like, he must be a genius, like, I don't know.
So was Davy very much set on becoming a jockey from a very young age?
The first word he uttered was horsey. I suppose it probably came from me big time, really, but he always wanted to be riding horses. He was always involved in horses, and when he was a young fella, if I was going somewhere, before I'd be in the car, he'd be in the car going with me, if there was anything to do with horses. We gave him great support. Growing up, he got great support. He had a good pony, and he always looked like that he was going to make the grade. He was very determined, very single-minded, which he still is today, and minds his own business, keeps a low profile. He's very level-headed, very solid. We treat him basically at home like anyone else in the family. Look, he could get a bit of a bollocking as quick as anything else too if he was to step out of line, and I think that helps him as well.
Where does your own love for horses come from, would you say?
I always had a love for horses, really. And coming through in the 30s and 40s and the 50s, people had no money, still had interest, but my father couldn't afford a pony or a horse for me. So it was only when I came to Ireland and earned a few quid that I could afford to have a pony for the kids and go on from there, really.
Nowadays, you still breed a few?
We've gone very big into the breeding. Now we've about 15 brood mares, is probably too many, but there's a lot of hard work in it, really, and a lot of luck. This year, now we've had a good return out of the mares and foals. We have a lot of cold foals and a lot of nice stock, but there's a lot of work in it, really. I've bred a few good horses. I was lucky enough to breed a couple of good ones down through the years. Colonel Braxton, bred a few more as well, but so Colonel Braxton's the one that comes to mind. He was a grade one winner. Unfortunately, he got killed as a young Chinook horse, as an 8-year-old. He might have won the National if he survived, but that's National Hunt racing. That's the way it goes. We still dream that we're going to get a good one. And I think I have a good one coming up.
Tell us more.
Well, he's a young horse coming up. He's showing all the signs of being a nice horse, but look, time will tell. Maybe tomorrow we would have nothing. He might have an accident. That's just the game you're in. You must take that as well. David is after taking over the farm. He's the man now. I'm only the has-been, really. So he has a lot of nice stock coming up, and he has a lot of nice brood mills. So a lot of it is luck, really, I suppose.
Davy's mam Phyllis has been keeping a close eye on her son's career. Like any parent, she worries about the pitfalls of her son riding horses over obstacles and the risks attached. Still, Davy has brought plenty of joy to both herself and Jerry.
He has changed our lives completely because every day our afternoons, or nearly every day our afternoons, are taken up watching racing, which wouldn't be a thing I'd do normally. But we have to see that he gets home safe. We enjoy watching him, but it's very hard to watch him over the fences. We worry a lot about him, and anybody, other jockey, we enjoy watching, but I have to close my eyes every time he goes over a fence.
He's clearly had great success. What would be the highlight for yourself, Phyllis?
Well, the Gold Cup, of course.
And they're off.
Jerry and myself were over in Tenerife at the time and enjoyed it very much over there, but we would have preferred if we were there to welcome him back in. It was a great achievement, and everybody in York have enjoyed this as well. They all had him back.
Davy's association with Jigginstone was brought to an end on New Year's Eve in 2013. It was understandably a huge blow, but testament to his strength and character, he took it on the chin. Although Jigginstone were supplying Davy with some high-class horses, he was and still is in demand from several other trainers and owners around the country. If people thought that he was finished as a rider, they couldn't have been more wrong.
Next is Cloudy 2, Bobsworth, the giant bolster.
Irish hopes were not at all high heading into the Cheltenham Gold Cup of 2014. The Nicky Henderson-trained Bobsworth was sent off the favourite to retain his crown. However, Davy Russell and 20-1 shot Lord Windermere had other ideas. Davy, March 2014 provided you with your greatest success today. You won the blue ribbon event, the Cheltenham Gold Cup.
Yeah, well, I suppose I started the year before because I was lucky enough. I still had the Jigginstone job, and they had no runner for some reason in the RSA. It was quite surprising that they had no runner, you know. And Jim had no one to ride Lord Windermere in the RSA, and lucky enough, I don't know why, but I came available, and he won, and it was great, and that was marvellous. And then, you know, we moved on, and I don't think I rode him a couple of times then before Cheltenham or after. He didn't run after the RSA, and then maybe I didn't ride him his first run back, maybe. And then when I lost the job in January, I was lucky enough to be able to ride Lord Windermere his prep run for Cheltenham, and he ran well in Leopardstown. And you know, we were going there hoping that he'd definitely be in the frame and run a nice race. And his main opposition were the horses that he beat the year before in the RSA, so without fancying him or saying that he'd win, he was entitled to be there, you know what I mean, and he was entitled to finish in the frame. As regards tactics, they definitely weren't. I didn't plan to be as far behind, but I didn't plan for Lord Windermere to run as lazily as he did. He was very much behind the bridle because he gets quite wound up before a race and he sweats an awful lot. He gets a white sweat out in him, and for some reason that year he got quite warm in the parade, and you know, I was all the time trying to settle him down because I was of the opinion that if I did jump out too handy and I got keen, that he wouldn't be able to beat them horses that he had beaten the previous year. So I decided to settle him in, and then he just settled nearly too well. He just fell asleep in the race. But the one thing he did do was he jumped quite well, and it didn't go... They went quick at the start, but it, through the middle part of the race, it gave me a chance to hang on to him, and they didn't quicken, and they started quickening quite early. In the middle part of the race, it was okay. I was able to hang on to him, and just maybe three quarters of the way through, they started quickening quite early, and I came off the bridle, and I was just kind of rowing away because I was always keeping tabs on him. The horses that were around me weren't getting away from me, and I was passing the odd one or two, and he was jumping very well. And then all of a sudden, you know, when I come to the second last at the bottom of the hill, they were no further away from me. I winged the second last, and I think I passed two or three horses in the air at the second last, and he just landed the second last and ran down to the last full of horse, and he winged that again and landed kind of upsides in front, or maybe a length behind. And he's a divil then when he gets a lot of room and a lot of space in front of him. He doesn't run into the space. He runs at horses, but he won't run away from horses, if you know what I mean. And just landed at the back of the last, and he pricked his ears then, and he started running around and looking at the crowd. The other horses were close enough to him. He just kept doing, just barely doing enough, and luckily enough, he was in front of the line.
And final vent, Salvini on the contest.
great day. It was a bit surreal, really, because then, you know, I'd won the Gold Cup and then I had to wait for the Stewart's inquiry. And then when that, you know, it's kind of hard to take it in all in one go. And actually, he knew that I'd won the Gold Cup before I knew I won the Gold Cup, because there was a roar went up outside and I had to peep out the window to see who was celebrating. So I saw Jim and Dr. Lamb were celebrating, so I knew then I'd won the Gold Cup. Yeah, it was great.
And for the winner, Lord Windermere, and the runner-up on his own, to be bred in such close proximity to one another, I mean, it's an incredible story, Davy.
Yeah, well, it's amazing because, you know, I grew up around this area knowing all these people all our lives, and we've soldiered away there going to Pint of Pints, and they're breeding horses, and, you know, it's very hard to breed horses, like, and you look at the television there every week and you see these very good horses, and all of a sudden, you know, you're looking at the biggest race of all time, and they grew up literally out the road, you know, and I was a bit, not disappointed, but it was a bit, I don't know whether there was enough made of it at the time.
That day at the Cotswolds provided the East Cork native with his greatest triumph to date. The local connection didn't end there, however, as Lord Windermere was bred in Killa by Edmund Coleman, and the runner-up, on his own, was bred just a few miles up the road by Noel Tracy. Winning breeder Coleman was understandably delighted to have been associated with the winner of the big one.
Delighted. That's what we all aim to do, is to win, you know, in Cheltenham, and the Gold Cup was a big plus, like, it's the blue ribbon, really, I suppose.
So, Ed, you own the dam of Lord Windermere?
Yeah, I bought Satellite Dancer when she was about an 8 year old, and she was in foal, and she had her first foal was a filly, and I'd say Lord Windermere was about the fourth foal out of her. And I sold him at Tattersall's in November. I got nice money for him. He was a good foal. He was always, you know, looked the part. And he came back again to the Derby sale, but wasn't sold. And that fall of the year, he was sold in a breeze up in Doncaster. And Jim Cullity bought him there. And he went on after that.
What were your first impressions of Lord Windermere as a foal, would you say? And what were your initial expectations for him?
I only had him for about 6 months. You know, I sold him as a foal. So, but he was a very good foal. Now he made 33,000 as a foal. So he had to be a good foal to get that money. Like, could you say he was going to win a Gold Cup? No, but you know, anyone that's born, you kind of say, ah, this is the one. Like,
I'd imagine you'd follow their career closely when you sell them on.
You'd follow him where they go, and you'd be kind of looking out for them when they're named in, and you know, you'd be kind of waiting then until they go on the track, like.
And looking back now, what do you remember of the day of the Cheltenham Gold Cup of 2014?
The same day, Lord Windermere's mother was due to foal. Her time was up, and I didn't go over at all because his form going into the race wasn't great, so I wasn't expecting him to win it anyway. So, yeah, I watched it at home, and very exciting it was, yeah.
And the damn Satellite Dancer, she has clearly been a great servant.
She has, yeah. She's, let's say, there's six of them after running, and there's five of them after winning on the track, and there's one after winning 2 point to point, so as a broodmare, she's nearly 100% strike rate, like. You know, she's two black types after being bred from her.
And Edmund, your dad would have bred a few good horses.
My father, he I suppose, I was about eight when he bought his first mare, thoroughbred mare, and he always had thoroughbreds around the place, like, so that's where my interest came from. He was lucky, he was very lucky with him. He bred Oscar Time and Namelock and Saxophone. He used to put the odd one in training, and he was very lucky on the track. I think he had about 21 wins on the track as an owner. He bred a lot of them as well.
A few inches was all that separated Lord Windermere and on his own at the finish line at Cheltenham. A few miles is all that separates their respective breeders. It was a great feat for Killa's Noel Tracy to have bred the runner-up in racing's blue ribboned event. Like the winning breeder, Noel's family too have a strong association with the sport of horse racing.
It stemmed from my mother's people back in the 30s. They always came horses, they were jockeys. There was a generation went in, there was no horse like. And next thing, I bought a horse and I started the cycle off again. But there was four jockeys in my mother's side. And some of them very old jockeys, Matthew Reardon, Dan Barry, John Cotter, and there was a Cotter lad, another Cotter lad riding there of late, but he retired. But it started off there. So I decided to get a horse and I started off with one. And now I have five mares.
So you have the mother of On His Own, Youghal na mBiara, she's called.
That was the first dam I bought. And she was going great. She won four races and she kind of broke down.
You then retired her and bred from her. She was covered by Presenting and On His Own was born. What were your immediate impressions of the horse, On His Own?
As a foal, he looked at a smashing horse. He was a fine big horse and he was a grand striding horse. And to look at him, there was something about him. There was something about him. So I sold him as a foal. 38,000 I sold him for that time. And it was a good price from that time because horse wasn't that dear. And he was the only one of that family that done well. I sold him for 38,000 and he was sold on. And he went to the Brightwell sales in Cheltenham and he made 320,000, which was a pile of money. A pile of money.
It must have been great to have read the runner up in the Cheltenham Gold Cup. I know you would have liked if On His Own won, but a remarkable story nonetheless.
Edmund Coleman and myself were fighting out the finish, came in from the one parish, and Edmund got the verdict by a whisker. Yeah, it's an incredible life. It'll never again happen as a boss.
Along the small stretch of road on the N25 from Killett to Youghal is an area that has produced a 1-2 in the Cheltenham Gold Cup in the greatest amphitheatre of them all. So we've seen Davy Russell, the Cheltenham Festival winning jockey, the champion jockey, the breeder. Could we see Davy Russell, the trainer, in years to come?
Yes, I'd love to. I love the idea of training horses. I'd actually be more than happy to do it, but the amount of money it costs and the way you have to deal with owners and things, I just might not be the best man to go at it. I'd rather, you know, keep it low key and go at it at a different angle. Maybe I like producing young horses. I like working around young horses, and that might suit me better.
In episode 2, we look further into the local breeding industry and examine the challenges faced by local breeders and stud farms. Leading the Field was funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with a television licence fee. It was produced and presented by Jordan McCarthy, edited by Tom Maher, and the sound engineer was Thomas O'Keeffe. A Community Radio Youghal production.